Hello everyone. Today I'm going to talk about how all the different theorists briefly, so you can see James Masterson's integrative approach to diagnosing narcissistic, borderline, and schizoid personality disorders. There's a method to the madness here, I promise. Recall Margaret Mahler, and her autistic, symbiotic phases to infant development, but more specifically the rapprochement and rapprochement crisis she talks about. Where the rapprochement crisis is resolved through object constancy, then later object permanence. Then there is Daniel Stern, who emphasized an innate will to independence, and proposed layers to development, with a self-regulating other, where the attunements or purposeful misattunements contribute greatly to the development of personality in an infant. His work was in contrast to Mahler, where he found no evidence of an autistic or symbiotic phases. He went on to describe different selves, with the first being the emergent self, next the core self, then there is the subjective and intersubjective self, and lastly the verbal self giving way to the narrative self. He also stressed that it is everyday small moments rather than single, dramatic events that shape a child's self. He also emphasized that the self is shaped throughout one's lifetime, and there is always an opportunity envelope of correction. Again, the child is co-creator with a natural will towards independence. Now we have Dr. Alan Shore, infant brain researcher and psychoanalyst. He has found that a baby is born without higher cortical functions, and describes the self being formed through the right orbital cortex as the brain grows. This area of the brain lies at the apex of the limbic system, all working in concert to produce affect, or emotion. He found that explicit memory doesn't occur until the ages of 2 or 3. So, at the center of control of affect is the right orbital frontal cortex. Furthermore, he emphasizes external stimuli and genetic expression, where the mother is the main source of stimuli who mediates genetic differences. He found that attachment can be observed beginning around 10 to 12 months with the expression of positive affect from the child. Moreover, Shore goes on to say that when two people match their subjective experiences, this forms an empathic bond where healing can take place. Also, where there is object constancy, or as infants we internalize the mother object, one will tend to feel secure, or have secure attachment styles. He says when our self begins to regulate our own emotions, we've gotten to our independent self. If a child cannot regulate, then they cannot individuate. And developmental trauma occurs if there is non-attunement abuse or neglect. Where there is trauma, there is an intense negative self and an inability to regulate their state, in other words affect dysregulation. Lastly, there is Heinz Kohut, the founder of self-psychology. In self-psychology, one would use sustained empathic inquiry and look at patterns from the patient's perspective, even if they're psychotic. In analysis, the therapist would look for the disruption repair cycle through the experience near function, and goes on to say that this is where healing can take place. He would go on to take a softer view of narcissism, compared to a Freud, or Kernberg, saying we all need it and that it is vital to our well-being. Now what about James Masterson? Here's a little bio from Wikipedia.com. A psychiatrist and psychoanalyst, Masterson was a founding authority on the theory and treatment of borderline and narcissistic personality disorders, as well as the understanding of personality disorder in general. At his death, he was clinical professor emeritus of psychiatry at Weill Medical College of Cornell University. He was also the founder and director of the Masterson Group for Clinical Treatment of Personality Disorder, as well as the Masterson Institute for Psychoanalytic Psychotherapy, later renamed the International Masterson Institute. Established in 1977, the IMI still offers psychotherapeutic training at its headquarters in Manhattan and on the West Coast in San Francisco, as well as training and treatment at its branches in Vancouver, Istanbul, South Africa, and Australia. Masterson was among the first to bring the psychoanalytic approach known as object relations theory, together with child development theory, to bear on the study of personality disorder. In so doing, He helped widen the lens through which disturbance in mental health is viewed, seeing beyond the classical Freudian approach, which is limited to neurotic symptomatology. In work he began in the mid-20th century, Masterson came to believe that the origin and treatment of personality disorders starts with understanding the formation of self and relationship that begins in the first 3 years of life, the so-called pre-Oedipal period. During this time, the mother's loving support of the child's emerging self is critical for healthy psychic maturation. The psychoanalysts Otto F. Kernberg, Ronald Fairbairn, D.W. Winnicott and Heinz Kohut also played seminal roles in developing the concept of personality disorder. In line with stressing the importance of maternal availability, Masterson argued that the personality disorders crucially involve the conflict between a person's two selves, the false self, which the very young child constructs to please the mother, and the real self. The psychotherapy of personality disorders is an attempt to put people back in touch with their real selves. Masterson, whose work also encompassed self-theory as well as the neurobiology of personality disorders, was the author of many books. Among them are The Personality Disorders Through the Lens of Attachment Theory and The Neurobiologic Development of the Self, A Clinical Approach, The Search for the Real Self, Unmasking the Personality Disorders of Our Age, written for a general readership, The Narcissistic and Borderline Disorders, and The Psychiatric Dilemma of Adolescence. A Distinguished Life Fellow of the American Psychiatric Association, he was also a Fellow of the American College of Psychoanalysts, a founder of the American Society of Adolescent Psychiatry and a past president of the Society's New York chapter. He's a pretty big deal as you can see. Now, the Masterson approach to personality disorders is integrative. Aha! That is why all the talk of other theorists. And you will see as we get into Masterson, that he takes the most helpful hypothesis and science to create the Masterson approach. His theories build on his theories taking from Shore's evidence that critical periods of maturation is at the end of the first year of like around 10 to 12 months, and that self-regulating others provide intense psychobiological attunement through reciprocal gaze transactions that generate and sustain positive effect in the mother-baby dyad. These interactions induce particular neuroendocrine changes that facilitate deep sites in the orbital frontal areas of the right hemisphere as well as areas of the limbic system. This imprinting experience initiates the maturation of a frontal limbic system that is responsible for the developmental adaptations in the beginning phase of the practicing period. In relation to narcissism, knowing from Mahler and Shore what the practicing period means, it is important to be specific. So, during the practicing subphase, which occurs between 12-18 months, the child acquires locomotion, first through crawling and then by walking upright. More than any other psychoanalytic theorist of her time, Mahler recognized the crucial importance of mobility in the development of the child. During this period, the infant reaches the highest point in primary narcissism. The toddler is in a state of omnipotent exhilaration, the ideal ego, or the illusion of omnipotence from a merger with an attuned caregiver, is at its fullest. In this subphase, the child explores the world and becomes aware, for the first time, that he or she is an object of observation by others. Clinical literature points to massive affective changes occurring during this time in infant development. Specifically, Shore notes it is the emotion of shame, with its deep physiological substrate, that makes its first appearance. Shore speculates that at this stage in infant growth, the sympathetic portion of the autonomic nervous system is more developed, causing hyperarousal and behavioral overexcitation. This also corresponds to Kohut's age-appropriate exhibitionism. A biological shame system then emerges as an evolutionary inhibitory control mechanism. I think it's interesting to note here about shame, is that it isn't a learned behavior, we're wired for it. And as we all know from experience, some don't have it at all. Like Dr. George Simon says, try to shame someone who doesn't have shame. It doesn't work. Anyway, the establishment of the capacity to form an interactive representational model that underlies an early functional system of affect regulation. Masterson goes on to say that the second significant change occurs in the second year with the onset of socialization. From 14 to 16 months, transactions are a form of hypoarousal, and these stress states serve as an optimal expansion of the other limbic circuits. By 18 months, there is a mature differentiated orbital frontal system at the end of this critical period. Of particular interest, Masterson says that none of the researchers found any developmental grandiosity or developmental splitting. They presume grandiosity must arise from the identification with parent, which I thought was also very interesting. So basically, attachment researchers suggest that Mahler was studying infants with insecure attachment and not secure attachment. By the way, her work was focused on psychotic infants, and much of her research comes into question regarding normal development. But Masterson does agree that her work is very clinically useful, but her research subjects and methods are questionable. So, how do we understand the contradictions between Mahler's theories and Stern's attachment research? Masterson says to keep in mind that Mahler was a pioneer, and with that comes pitfalls, but overall her contributions remain helpful. Furthermore, Masterson points out something I think is obvious, but nonetheless noteworthy, that with developmental research we can never know what goes on in the infant's psyche. At best, we can observe behavior and create hypotheses and educated guesses. Now, moving on to arrest of normal development, also called pathological development. Masterson states, saying there is an arrest in normal development, there is a pathological form of development related to difficulties with attachment. In other words, attachment styles have to do with the child, more so than relying completely on the mother to foul things up. Basically, insecure attachment is a clue to a pathology already in place. Wow. Huh? This particular view is one I've held since I started researching child development, and specifically narcissism. But, this also brings us to what came first, the chicken or the egg? Something we'll probably never fully know. Finally, Masterson summarizes that even Freud had to switch up models eventually, and as such one needs to look at all developmental working models that may highlight better one part from another. Mahler's theory, whether derived from secure to insecure attachment, is still helpful in clinical issues with borderline disorders, and Stern's theories highlights best attunement to self-work with narcissistic personality disorders. Attachment theorists, with their focus on how the child maintains attachment to the maternal object, works best with schizoid, paranoid, and psychopathic patients. Furthermore, Shore's work highlights the neurobiological basis for the sense of self, and reinforces Mahler's notion of the importance of the mother role for the sense of self, and also opens up the possibility that psychotherapy may be helpful. In conclusion, taking an integrative approach such as Masterson's just makes the most sense. Nearly every theorist has something to offer as infant research and science catch up with one another. But all in all, having experienced a narcissist, you can see here exactly where they are stuck developmentally. It is in the rapprochement crisis, where object permanency never took hold, and the narcissist forever seeing themselves as omnipotent and grandiose, never wanting to accept reality as it is, only how they want it to be. The act of splitting is a defense against reality so that they remain forever young. Never having a balanced view of themselves or others only leads to, of course, an untold number of victims in their damaged path. They are literally the little tyrant, the four-year-old playing king, never seeing the world in shades of gray, because if they did, they would be held accountable. Aside of the obvious failure in strategy to resolve the rapprochement crisis, is the interesting view on attachment. Yes, most definitely some mothers will fail miserably in their taking proper care of their infants, which might lead to insecure attachment of the child. However, the view that insecure attachment, not because of non-attunement of the mother, is a symptom of a bigger issue, pathology, hits home for me. Then there is the development of shame. Shame not as a learned behavior, but as a real manifestation of the human neurobiological system. I know for myself, as well as some here, it's highly questionable if the narcissist really does experience shame. I know for sure, they are experts at shaming, but is that because this is yet another failure on the part of Mother Nature? Well, that's it for now, and in my next video I plan to go into the psyche of the personality disordered according to Masterson. Be sure to like, comment and subscribe. Also, follow me on Facebook, Narcissist Free Almost, and on Instagram, at Clumber Lover. And as always, I do hope you have found peace of mind living narcissist free. I know I am. Love to all.